My name is Lisa Mann with the OHSU Parkinson Center, and we welcome you to the Clinic Care to Community Program Partnerships that I'm talking about today is building a better model. And this is really a unique gathering for two different reasons. First of all, we're bringing together, probably for the first time anywhere, physical therapists and exercise trainers in the goal of building a community for our Parkinson's disease clients and yours that will be hopefully much better continuity for them. And we'll talk a little bit more about that in a moment. The other side is we're bringing in mental health professionals as well. We'll be talking to them about managing anxiety, depression, and psychosis in Parkinson's. Again, this is a little bit unique because we haven't had a lot of outreach to mental health professionals in our community, and yet it's such an important part of Parkinson's care. And so combining these today, again, is a look at trying to build a better model of community between ourselves as medical professionals, with our medical professionals in the community, and other professionals who are helping our patients. So I'm going to talk a little bit about why we have to have a special approach in caring for people with Parkinson's disease. I'm also going to talk about team care and how that's being reimagined, as well as looking at the clinic to community concept that I'm starting to introduce to you today. And then finally, I'll focus on why the particular audiences that we've picked for today's program. So those of you who have worked with people with Parkinson's disease, which I'm assuming are many of you, are probably quite well aware of the variety of experiences that people with Parkinson's disease have. First of all, it is very variable between patients. Everybody is a little unique in how they present. That means in their symptoms, how they'll progress, as well as, you know, what treatments will be effective for them. It's also very unpredictable in these same areas. So the individual person with Parkinson's will be unlike his cohort that he meets, whether it's in an exercise class or in a clinic. And therefore, it's very important that we look at them as individuals and we devise treatment plans that are individualized. Also, Parkinson's disease is much more than motor symptoms. That's how we define it, is by, you know, changes in ability to move. And Julie Carter will be talking about that more lately during the medical review. But it also involves non-motor symptoms. This is a disorder of the brain. Therefore, it has the potential to affect all systems of the body. And in Parkinson's disease, it often does. There's up to about 30 different non-motor symptoms that you might see in Parkinson's disease. And for any one individual, they could experience on average 9 to 12 of those during the course of their disease. So there's a lot of other things going on that we have to take into account. Also, there are some limits to the standardized treatments, and we're going to talk about that. Individualized treatment, I've already said, is required. And each stage as they progress becomes increasingly complicated, as you can imagine. So what this means for the individual is that the person and their family are impacted, not only physically, but psychologically, financially, really in all realms of their life. So their quality of life is very much changed by Parkinson's disease. And so, as we started to look at Parkinson's disease and how to help patients more, it's become more and more obvious that we need to involve experts in other areas, not just the physician or nurse practitioner who is caring for the patient, who might be prescribing medications or eventually referring them for surgery. We really have to look at the whole individual and other experts in the community that can help us out. Part of that need is going to be growing much more in the near future. Obviously, we have people like myself who are a part of the baby boomer generation that are now entering the ages of diagnosis, most commonly diagnosed age for people with Parkinson's disease. And that will then continue to grow. We expect people with Parkinson's disease to double in the next 25, 30 years. And that's just in the United States. It also will probably be worldwide. So that bears a lot of burden on those who are caring for them, as well as the people who are experiencing it. People are also living longer with disability. So all of this together means that we have to come up with new ways to care and treat for them. And also we have to find new ways to fit it within the medical insurance model that we have in the United States, because the cost for caring for people with Parkinson's are increasing and will continue to increase dramatically. Obviously, I've put up some figures here of some recent studies that have shown that the direct costs, and this was as of 2010, were about $14.4 billion with people with Parkinson's disease. That means people who've been hospitalized or had acute care events. For their age group, that's about another $8 billion above what you would expect to see. There's also many indirect costs, loss of employment, changes in their life that is affected, you know, home care, things like that, that can cost another $6.3 billion. And again, I would expect to see these costs as well double as the population doubles. And in fact, the figures that were used in these particular studies estimated the population of people diagnosed with Parkinson in 2010 at being about 60,000, or I'm sorry, yeah, 60,000. We actually think it's closer to a million, maybe even a million and a half. So those figures could be much higher. So right now, the current medical model is monodisciplinary. We're focused on people who are caring for people with Parkinson's in the community are focused on medication regimens that can be very complicated, and possibly surgery if it's appropriate. Understand that most people with Parkinson's disease are probably being cared for by a primary care physician. Only about 40% may be seen by a neurologist, and only about 20% of those are going to be seen by a specialty center such as ourselves. So it really, the treatment that they receive and the recommendations they receive vary quite a bit. And so part of our goal at OHSU, Parkinson Center of Oregon, is to start to train medical providers in different areas and different disciplines in order that they understand the verities and different aspects of Parkinson's disease. Because it really does make a difference in how the individual is able to maintain their function over time. So this is not exactly a new concept. It's one that was promoted nationally and now internationally. And that's performing or gathering together a team of individuals, medical professionals, that can be referred to help care for people with Parkinson's. Ours, of course, include our physical, occupational, and speech therapists. Social worker is very important because of the impact on finances and life changes and on the caregiver strain. Nurses play an important role, but this is not always available out in the community where most of our patients live. In fact, about half of our patients live in what we name a rural area, but really is just not a large metro area that has the sorts of services available that we do here in the Portland metro area. But they may have rehabilitation teams that concentrate on neurology. So we've gone out in several areas, as you can see from the map, and started to train teams in these areas about Parkinson's disease and what the latest research is in physical, occupational, and speech therapy that can help the individual and the healthcare provider provide them with the best care possible. And this is now accepted as, for specialty care, being a team approach. So involving at different stages, preferably earlier rather than later, before there's an acute event, and when there are changes occurring for the individual, those therapists that can most answer their needs. This, at this time, has not included also mental health therapists, but as you'll see, there is a huge need for that, and we often use referrals to mental health therapists, whether it's counselors, neuropsychiatrists, psychiatrists, psychologists, to help many of our patients. So a very important part of our team approach, but again, not necessarily available in the general community because the healthcare providers are not familiar with Parkinson's disease and its unique aspects. So we've tried to develop a team approach, tried to train people outside our areas that we can refer to and who can refer back to us in order to offer expert care to people with Parkinson's disease wherever they live. Because we know that if they're able to make that connection, that they're much more likely to continue therapy and to benefit from therapy. And so our team PD, as we call it, it's short for Therapist Educated and Aligned in Managing Parkinson's Disease, team PD, is a program that we continue to offer training such as this one. We continue to stay connected with those we've trained through a quarterly newsletter with information, and we hope in the future to offer more trainings and grow this network of care. But there are limitations to it, and I'll tell you a little bit about those. First of all, it's only now starting to have research in these areas to look at not only how physical, occupational, and speech therapy can help improve people with Parkinson's disease. Most of the research has been in physical therapy, which is probably obvious why it would be. But occupational and speech therapy have so much to offer as well. And so more and more is being done in each of these areas. And so that's important to show that it is effective. But also, only in the Netherlands right now, there is a look at, does team care for people with Parkinson's make a difference? And they're really starting to approach it in a very scientific way. They've developed a network that is actually throughout their country, which was a bit daunting for me until I found out that their country is actually smaller than Oregon. So I felt like I could still keep trying and hopefully grow ours, that I didn't need to do it quite as quickly as they did. But it is starting to bear some fruit in looking at how does team function, where does it improve things, does it hurt things, is there follow through, and it has at least shown in its early stages that it is very important for the therapist. They feel the training makes a huge difference in their ability to deliver care. They also find that it overall has saved costs, at least in the Netherlands. And so it looks like there is definitely an approach that we want to keep studying and offering care for. We just have anecdotal evidence right now as to how it works for our individual patients. So more research needs to be done. We also need to have Parkinson's savvy providers, facilities and resources, so that people who may not be seeing us are getting those referrals so that they can grow a base for the therapists that are in the communities. The more people you see, the more you understand, the more you're able to actually apply the information that we're training. So it's very important to have that training for prescribers and team members, which we're, again, working at in conferences such as these. There are also, of course, cost and coverage limits in this with our insurance programs that we have, and particularly for the majority of patients, they're, of course, under Medicare, and so there are caps and limitations on that that make it quite challenging. And also post-therapy follow-through. Again, depending on the patient, you know, staying motivated to do exercise and to do the things that have been taught by the medical therapist can be very hard to do. And this is where we've started to look at the importance of involving exercise trainer and other community providers that can help with that and really have strong understanding of what it means to motivate individuals, what it means to work with them either as individuals or as groups to achieve a certain goal. And so that's partly what has driven us to this new enhanced Parkinson's disease care model. And this is something really we're kind of just starting to propose. And that's multidisciplinary, which we already have, but also multimodality, really a seamless transition from clinic to community and then back to clinic again. And so over the time that you are with us, you will start to see and learn more about Parkinson's disease itself, but also start to apply from your own viewpoints how that can you can serve the people in your community with the tips that you're learning, but also understand when it might be appropriate for them to go back and see their specialist and be able to, you know, advocate for them and help them in that way. So again, we feel that it's going to make a huge difference in being able to make this continuity of care last throughout the course of their disease. They don't just leave us after they've had, you know, three or four physical therapy sessions and then drop it. They can go to classes, they can go to, you know, individual exercise training, or they can follow up with a counselor in their community closer to home. And we actually have a very robust community, and many of you are here, who have already started such classes. But one of our goals is really to deepen your understanding of Parkinson's disease and really start that dialogue between us so that we can make sure that this becomes more seamless, that the people with Parkinson's and their family are getting to you, and when you see them starting to have problems, that it's appropriate for them to come back to us so we can work in partnership. Partly why we've chosen exercise trainers, physical therapists, and mental health providers, it can be illustrated in this study done by the National Parkinson's Foundation, which is the Parkinson's Outcomes Project. This is actually a registry program where patients at centers throughout the United States, and actually four countries are involved now, go into their provider, and at least once a year have a very thorough examination. You know, they do things like timed up and go. They get depression scale given, a caregiver strain score. Things like this are done once a year, and they're gathering all this data. And right now they have over 5,500 people enrolled in it. So it's a huge database and has a great potential for helping us to find out what are the best ways to care for people with Parkinson's disease. And of course, one of the things that we found out is that the individuals noted that the greatest impact on their health status, really they rated as mood and depression, which is a significant problem in people with Parkinson's disease. Obviously a non-motor symptom, and therefore something that has been shown in various studies to really be important, and therefore vital to have community healthcare providers, mental health providers that understand Parkinson's and can help them with that. Also, 2 and 3 were activities of daily living and mobility issues. So we've seen more and more that exercise makes a difference in people with Parkinson's disease. Research is suggesting that it might even be neuroprotective. And so in specialty centers, we really promote doing exercise. But you know, if you're depressed, if you're apathetic, if your mood fluctuates, staying motivated to do that is very difficult. So really this is a natural partnership for us to really begin and look at how we can approach both sides and hopefully make our clients successful. The other thing that the study showed that I thought was interesting, in those people who said that they exercised regularly, so that was more than 2.5 hours per week, they noted lower degrees of mobility impairment, not surprising, lower degrees of caregiver burden, which is very important and a significant aspect of what people with Parkinson's and their families experience, and also lower degrees of impairment for everyday activities. So definitely, you know, something that is also bearing out in research is being borne out by those individuals who may not be involved in a research study. So basically what we're saying is that the now tried and true phrase of it takes a village really to care for someone with Parkinson's disease. We need to have more people, more resources, more facilities that understand the unique aspects of Parkinson's disease and how to treat it. Because we have definitely had people come back to us after they've gone out into their community, they lived far from here, weren't able to see our physical and occupational and speech therapy team that has been trained especially in Parkinson's disease and sees many patients, and they've gone and they said, you know, that really didn't do anything for me. It was kind of a waste of my time. And we don't want that to be the case because so much can be done to make a difference. So making sure that we do reach out and get those referrals going to knowledgeable people in the communities. And of course, there is a special challenge with mental health care, not only from the insurance side, but finding people and, you know, making sure that we connect them in the community. So that's another challenge that we're hoping to now start to just make inroads to in today's conference. So the specialty centers are very few, and if they are able to go to them, often they have to travel great distances. Medical treatment is limited in the sense that medications can do wonders, and there's lots of research going on about new medications, but we're not slowing the disease and we're not stopping the disease. So there's still much more to be done there. And Julie will talk more about what happens as the treatments go on and they go on higher and higher doses. There's also surgery, very expensive and only appropriate for certain people. So as people live longer with disease, as we are more successful with treatments at keeping them functioning, they're gonna still need to be able to understand how to work within the limitations that they do have to the utmost of their ability, and that's where we all come into play. So the clinic to community partnership may, and we are very much hoping it does, improve continued participation in therapy. So if someone ends their medical therapy and goes out into the community, our therapists are going to be able to have people that they can recommend they go see or follow up with to continue the things that they've gained and sustain, really, and extend the functional effectiveness that they've gotten through medical therapy. Also, we want to improve social connection among people with Parkinson's disease, not only finding one another as they may go to exercise groups or whatever, but also within the community. So as more and more people understand Parkinson's disease, the easier it is for them to be able to connect, go out in the community, and actually hopefully reverse the trend, which is quite common, and that's self-isolation in Parkinson's disease, because they become very self-conscious of a tremor, of their inability to maybe keep up with the conversation because their thinking processes might have slowed down. So a host of reasons for why it's important to maintain or promote social connectedness. And in fact, there's starting to be research done that's showing that it may be them being in groups with other people that has a significant impact on their ability to perform better. So that's also being researched. Finally, our goal, and not only at the OHSU Parkinson Center, but I'm sure all of your goal as well because you're here to learn more about Parkinson's, is to really improve the quality of life of the patient, of the caregiver, and of their family. We want them to do what they want to do for as long as they can do it. And when they start to have limitations on that, make sure that they can adjust and continue to stay involved in life to the utmost, whatever that means for them. And so it really is going to take all of us to achieve that. And so I thank you and applaud you for coming, for learning more about Parkinson's, and for connecting with those people in your community who have Parkinson's disease and helping them to improve their quality of life. Thank you. The question was, what does our vision look like for really bringing the referrals not only out to the community, but back in to the clinic when appropriate, and how that might work? And so our vision is that we are going to present to you a model, particularly tomorrow in more depth, that looks at how we do that, how our physical therapists and an exercise trainer we know communicate the recommendations they have, the strengths that they have that each one can offer, and how to understand when there might be an appropriate time to say, you know, things are changing for you, you're having more instability, maybe you're missing classes more, maybe there's a moodiness, whatever it might be, that can kind of trigger an understanding of, you know, it might be good to check in with your healthcare provider, or particularly go back to a physical occupational or speech therapist. So we'll talk more about that tomorrow. Yes?
You mentioned that Parkinson's is doubling by 2030. Mm-hmm.
So why is Parkinson's expected to double by 2030 is primarily due to the baby boomers entering in that age group. And you'll see if you look at any population graph, as the baby boomers enter into it, basically, you know, they drag a lot with them. And that includes the diagnosis of Parkinson's disease. So they're starting to hit 65 now, which is the average age of diagnosis for Parkinson's disease, and therefore, as they continue into the process, there'll be more and more people that are diagnosed with it. There is no indication that I'm aware of that there is a rise in Parkinson's disease because of any environmental issue or anything like that. Yes?
You mentioned that your grant tried to involve social workers and kind of a mental aspect to Parkinson's. Is currently Parkinson's referred to as a mental or partially a mental disability, or is it just referred to as a physical disability?
So it is Parkinson's disease considered a mental disability as well as a physical disability? It is among those people in the know. I think that it's not as generally recognized in the community as being an issue that affects mental health, but it has a great impact on a variety of areas of mental health, not only cognitive changes that occur in memory, slowness of thinking, communication issues, but also mood issues, depression, apathy, which can occur separately in Parkinson's disease from depression, and psychoses that can be a part of the high doses of medications that they take. And so that's just a few of the mental health issues. And people who deal regularly with Parkinson's disease understand that, and that it does become a major part of treatment planning as the disease progresses.
But in terms of the folks, it's not defined as a mental issue?
I don't think so. In the textbooks, while they may eventually, you know, talk about it.
Attempt to make that change sooner so that we can bring in more social workers so it's defined as a mental disease?
I don't know the answer to that.
Sorry.
Yeah, maybe Julie might be able to address that after her presentation. Good question, though. Yes?
To piggyback on that, what kind of education are you giving to neurologists, primary care physicians, about the multifaceted approach to comprehensive treatment?
So how are we training physicians, nurse practitioners, physician assistants, and other neurologists in specialty care for Parkinson's disease? What we're doing is, over the last several years, we have offered primary care-focused CMEs. We've also gone out into communities in the team areas that I noted and done a special CME dinners with the neurologists and grand rounds with the physicians of the community in order to help them understand the different aspects of Parkinson's disease. It's been quite a challenge because, obviously, general neurologists and primary care physicians have so much on their plate that they have to keep up with, that it's often a little bit challenging for us to be able to get to the people that really need to know. So as part of that, we've also started to do like an annual newsletter that goes out to over 5,000 physicians, mainly primary care, gerontologists, neurologists, that focuses on different aspects of Parkinson's disease. And we've done two issues now, and both issues have talked about the importance of team care and early referrals and trying to get that message across as well. So it's an ongoing effort that we hope to be more and more successful at as we find new modalities to be able to deliver that in.
Thank you.
with the technology today.